You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where Tony Hsing takes us through what's new to Anomaly Detector multivariate capabilities. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're learning all about what's new in Anomaly Detector multivariate capabilities. Tony Hsing is with us. How you doing, my friend? Why don't you tell us who you are and what you do?
Very good. How are you, Seth? I'm the product PM of Azure Cognitive Service. So specifically working on Anomaly Detector Matrix Provider.
Fantastic. So let's start with, for those that don't know what Anomaly Detector is, can you give us a little bit of an overview of what the service does?
Yes. So Anomaly Detector basically is an AI service which help people to identify the anomaly in the time series data. And then, so this new capability is actually advancement of the AI that we could use a group of signal to identify a system level issues.
I see. So the new stuff. So before the anomaly detector, what it does is it takes a signal of stuff and it tells you when things are out of the ordinary. Basically, is that right?
That is correct.
Fantastic. So the new thing, multivariate anomaly detection, what does that mean?
Yeah, multivariate is basically multiple signals. So previously, the existing feature basically tell you based on one single signal and tell you, hey, there's something goes wrong. But there's actually a broader use case that, for example, the equipment health, you have probably more than 100 signals you need to make sense of. Let me give you a quick example. For example, you have a refrigerator which has three sensors, temperature, vibration, lights, but each of those sensors won't tell you too much about whether that refrigerator is working in a healthy mode or not. But holistically, if you look at all those sensors together, you can pretty much say, hey, this one is not working or is working correctly. So that is basically multivariate anomaly detection.
That's cool. So before, the service would tell you if there was a single signal that was anomalous. But now if you have multiple signals, together they can tell you if they're anomalous, even though one of them by themselves might not be anomalous. Is that right?
Yeah, that is perfect.
All right, so can you show us how it works?
Sure. So let me switch to the Jupyter notebook. Before I go to this more code level things, I just want to show you the visuals because I know people love visuals and it's more easier to understand. So here is a very simple use case. We have 5 time series, and all of them are pretty much random, right? So if you look at those 5 signals together, so those are basically some real production signal taken from some real use case in sensors. If you look at those, pretty much you cannot really make sense of those, but with the state-of-the-art AI, we can, look at these things holistically and use long history to train and to learn what the normal pattern will be like. And then as a result, you can see, hey, those the spikes here is basically the output generated from this model. So those are basically the markers that we say, hey, at this timestamp, we see that this group of signal has a problem, meaning that from system level, this equipment has a problem. And then, so this is pretty much can tell you, whether system level there's an issue, and you can actually do some fine tuning with the output, for example, with the, the severity parameters, you can tune the model performance, and as a result, you can see more or less anomaly being marked here. So let me scroll to the top and give you an overview about API first.
Got it.
Yeah. So here, the API, so we introduced about 7 new APIs, list models, train models, get a model, delete model, so those things. But most important thing is that, so this is basically a two-phase approach, right? So you first, based on the historical data, you train a model. And this training is you basically unsupervised approach. You don't need a label specifically. So what you you know, input is a series of time series. And then after the training, you get a model ID, and then you can use that model to do the inferencing, and then use the output result to do the you know, anomaly detection. And not only you get anomaly detection result, the more beautiful thing is that you also get you know, the contributor ranking. For example, that is very useful. For example, you can say, hey, you know, we detect this anomaly and we know which sensor is top contributor and how relevant they are in terms of contributing to these anomalies.
And in this case, it would be instead of a single signal, it's multiple signals. I'm looking at the API here, and there's a whole new, you know, REST API for multivariate. So it's multiple signals now that can actually together tell you if there's a problem.
That is correct.
Got it.
Yeah. And then to use that, this RESTful API is very easy. So you basically, you know, create a resource and get your endpoint and get your key. And, you know, after that, so then you can start to use those models. So let me just quickly run through. We have trained some models. So previously, you can see this run successfully and list all the models. So this is the result is a little bit messy, but you know, here's the, you know, the sample response in a more clean structure. Right. So you can pretty much see, hey, this model is created at this time, and what is model ID, whether status, and how many variables you know, has been used to train this model. So here is 18 variables. And then after that, you can actually do the training. So I will not do the training here because this takes some time. But what it does is that it will, you know, basically taking in a zip file. In that zip file, you put that in Azure blob. And in that zip file, you have a bunch of CSVs. Each CSV file represents one variable. And then, so you basically, you know, provide those as input of the API. And then this is basically the sample request. And as a response, you will get a model ID you can use in the future, you know, for the, you know, status querying, because the model training will take some time. The result itself will, you know, reply back with the, you know, some of the additional, you can use additional API, for example, this one, to get a model status because the training will take some time.
Can you go back 1 second? I want to make sure that I'm understanding it right. The part where you submit the model training, you're basically giving it a blob file. Is that right?
Yes, that is correct.
Can you scroll up to that part? Because I want to make sure that everyone sees that part. Because that's the part that I was like, well, how do you give it all of the data? Because it has a bunch. There it is. So basically, yeah. When you post, you're telling it exactly what data you want it to look at. And since it's multivariate, you're going to have a bunch of series in different CSV files that have been zipped up. Is that right?
That is very correct.
Okay,
that
cool. Okay, cool. Because that was a part that was a little confusing to me initially. It's like, well, how does it get all the data? This makes perfect sense. I'm sorry. Keep going.
Yeah, no problem. So when the training happens, you may want to, you know, get the status of the training. And then you use the multivariate model status API. And then as a result, so here, this is very important, this epoch ID. So it will return from 10 to 100. So this one will pretty much tell you about, you know, what's the percentage this model training are progressing. So it's 100 epoch in total. So, you know, use this and the latency in second, you will pretty much predict when this model training will probably complete. So once it is complete, you can use that for the inferencing with the, you know, detection API. So here you again, you know, use the new data you want to inference and put that in a similar fashion at the blog file, and then you know, post that to the inferencing endpoint.
So just to pause there. So now that the model's done, if you want it to actually do the predictions, then you give it another blob file and say, hey, predict on this new data. Is that right?
Yeah, that is correct. And then, so the result of this API, you know, it is a result ID. The result ID is the one you will be using, you know, to get the final detection result, the more detailed detection result. So this one is, you know, very useful and interesting because the output of this prediction result, there's a lot of information you can use to do either the visualization and, you know, also, like I mentioned earlier, about the contribution factors. So for example, you know, which variables, which sensors actually contribute more to these anomalies and how you rank that. But this is obviously the, you know, the response of this this one. And then let me see here in this section, the response part is very most useful part. So whether this timestamp is anomaly and what is severity, what is the raw score. And then you can hear in this part the contribution ranking score you can use to basically see, you know, how those variables ranked among this group. You can use that as a kind of, you know, root cause analysis, because you may want to understand, hey, this system level anomalies actually contribute more by this, you know, vibration sensor.
That's cool.
Yeah. So everything else you basically can, you know, based on all those rich information to, you know, do some plot and visualizations. So here is the basically we are going back to the previous visualization I show you at the start of the show. So here's the basically the five variables and whether that is anomaly. And you know, the raw score and the severities.
Yeah. So basically, once you send the data, the one thing I didn't understand is once you send the data to do the inference, how does the data come back? Is the data stored somewhere? Because I saw the response type, and the response type is basically telling you where the anomalies are, and that's what you're plotting there at the bottom. Is that right?
Yeah, that is right. All the information are in the response body.
Got it. This is cool. So is there anybody using this and how's it working for them?
Right. It's a great great question. So we have in our private preview working with some of the well-known company like Siemens, Airbus. So they have done the early piloting. So everything looks good and they have, you know, very accurate result. For example, Siemens used that in medical equipment testing. Their scenario is pretty much, you know, in the pre-production, they do intensive testing on their, you know, machines. And then you can imagine on that machine, there's a lot of sensors. So they use that sensor data to make sense of whether, you know, this equipment is good to go or not. Airbus, you know, is in a similar scenarios. For example, there's you know, potentially hundreds of signals from satellite or, you know, the airplanes. So they are, you know, doing this predictive maintenance things through the multivariate anomaly detection. Yeah.
Well, this is really cool. Where can people go to find out more?
Yeah, so there's we have a few links, you know, posted here, so people can read blogs and you know, find out additional information about how to write code and you know, how to construct a more complicated solution out of it.
Well, this has been awesome, my friend. Thanks so much for spending some time with us. And thank you so much for watching. We're learning about all about what's new to Anomaly Detector multivariate capabilities. Thank you so much for watching. And hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.